Another benefit of using rape. Whoops. Don't want to break another drive. Stay put. Everyone, and welcome to PaldaTech. Today is the second video in a multi-part series on the subject of data storage and organization. Today, it's all about RAID drives, which is probably the world's most boring subject. Until now. That's right, by the time you leave here today, you're going to have a better understanding of RAID than 98% of the world's population. First, a disclaimer. I personally own several of Synology's NAS storage units, and I use them every day. Synology did provide me with this one expansion bay unit and some external drives to assist in this video series. All other NAS units you may see, I purchased myself. I am not being paid by Synology to create any of these videos. That said, I want to give a big thank you to Synology for their support of this channel and being available to answer any questions that I've had. Let's begin. RAID stands for Redundant Array of Independent Disks. Inside a unit like this, and they are all working together to organize your files, your photos, your videos, etc. Now, the single most important thing for you to understand about RAID is this. RAID is not a backup. It should never replace a good backup strategy. We'll talk more about backup in future videos. RAID exists for three reasons. The first is to prevent hard drive failure from ruining your data. I have a whole box of drives here to prove my point. If it hasn't happened to you yet, you're lucky, but consider yourself as editing your photos and your files on borrowed time. Second, RAID gives you faster access to your files. And third, RAID provides a better solution than having all of these separate hard drives all over the place connected to your computer. It allows you to set up a unit like this, which is nothing more than, you know, just a bunch of hard drives. And once it's set up, the entire unit can appear as a single hard drive, which you can then browse, manage, and work with your data. Whenever you set up a NAS unit for the first time, you have to tell the unit which RAID configuration that it should use. I have narrowed down all of the possible RAID configurations to the 7 most important. And from those, we are then going to narrow down even further, and we will pick the one that's best for you. The first type of RAID configuration is called basic. It's exactly like you connect your external drives right now. Each drive is seen and operates as a completely separate hard drive. So, in the case of this unit, right, with 5 of these different drives, your computer would then show 5 different hard drives that you would have to manage separately. There's no advantage for photographers to use RAID basic. So, we're moving on. Okay. One down. Next is something called JBOD, and this stands for just a bunch of disks. This is slightly smarter than RAID Basic. In JBOD, you have a bunch of disks on your NAS, but you only see them as one drive, right? That's it. The problem with JBOD is that you don't have any of the benefits of RAID safety or data redundancy. So we're not going to use it. Okay, 2 out of the way. Now we come to the actual numbered RAID configurations, and the first one is called RAID 0, also known as disk striping. Now this is where your files are spread across 2 or more disks. Let me show you what I mean. So let's pretend that this is our JPEG file that we're storing on our RAID, okay? It's a single JPEG photo of a bowl of cereal. Here's how RAID 0 would store this file. Just like that. This RAID configuration is all about speed. It's very, very fast, right? And so when it accesses these drives, it quickly just pulls together all these pieces as fast as it can until you have your final image like this. And then it just pulls the file, and there you have it. But RAID 0 has a major problem. If one of these drives fails, the entire volume as a whole is completely lost. You lose everything, everything, completely. And in technical terms, that's called no-fault tolerance. And that'll make you mad, bad, and sad. You will lose all your data if one of those drives fails, so we sure as hell do not want RAID 0. Next. Now, here is RAID 1, otherwise known as disk mirroring. Now, with RAID 1, it requires at least two hard drives, okay? And what it does is it makes an exact duplicate. So it creates a complete, identical carbon copy of itself across every drive. Now, there's two main problems with RAID 1. The first is that your disk capacity gets cut completely in half. For example, suppose you go out and you spend your hard-earned money on two different 10 terabyte drives, right? Well, what should you get? You should get 20 terabytes of storage. 10 here, 10 here, that's 20 terabytes. But with RAID 1, remember that since the other drive is just a mirrored copy of the first, you only get a total amount of storage of 10 terabytes with two 10 terabyte drives, or exactly half of what you're paying for. The second problem with RAID 1 is that it has to do with people thinking that this is a good backup strategy. It's not. And this is because that second drive is not a backup drive. It's a mirror drive. And it's completely in sync with the first drive. Meaning that if you accidentally delete one file from one drive, it will also do the same to the copy of it on the other drive and so forth, right? So that they're always in sync. So just say no to RAID 1. Okay, now we come to RAID 5. Now pay attention to this one. RAID 5 requires at least three drives to work, which is no problem because many of these Synology units have more than enough bays. Here's how it works. Your data is spread across most of the disks, much like it is in RAID 0, so it's fairly fast. However, the difference here, and it's a big one, is that RAID 5 allows you to recover all of your data even if one of your hard drives fails. It does this by storing what's called parity data on one of the drives. This parity data is like a blueprint, right, for the file that you had originally been storing. And it allows the unit to recreate your files, photos, and videos, etc. So if one of your disks fails, it will then use the information in the parity file to reconstruct everything. Another benefit of using RAID 5 is that if you do have a drive that fails, say it's number 3 right here, it fails. The system will alert you to this. Grab another one, get a good drive, put it right in, that, and you're good to go. You can do this while the unit is on. This is called hot swapping. The NAS unit will then rebuild the entire system with your new drive in place, and you're good to go, as if nothing ever happened. Now, while all this sounds great, there is a catch in using RAID 5. You can't use all of the space on each drive for your data. RAID 5 needs space to store that parity information, right, that allows you to recover your data in the event a drive fails. So, for example, two 10 terabyte drives would give me maybe about 16 terabytes of storage under RAID 5 and not the full 20 terabytes. It's better than RAID 1, but you're still not getting the full amount of space on the drive that, you know, it says is usable. Now, I hate to sound pessimistic, but what happens if you're performing a recovery in RAID 5 and during that recovery, right in the middle of it, another drive fails, right? Well, you would lose everything in that case. Well, that's why we have RAID 6. RAID 6 is exactly the same thing as RAID 5, except you now have the data parity information stored on two disks, not just one. So now, if you lose the disk that contains the parity information while you're performing a recovery operation, a second disk is available to step in and continue the recovery process. Of course, by having that extra benefit of RAID 6, you are giving up even more space for the actual storage of data. So now you have about 60% less space. And lastly, we come to RAID 10. RAID 10 is a combination of RAID 1 and RAID 0, right? Get it? 1, 0, 10, It requires a minimum of 4 drives just to work. You get the speed benefit from disk striping in RAID 0, but with the safety of disk mirroring in RAID 1. It basically does what RAID 0 does, you know, spread all your data out, right? But then what it does is it mirrors those drives together so that you have that redundancy from RAID 1. It's basically very fast and redundant. However, you need double the amount of disks as in the other RAID configurations, and this RAID type it's often used for things like specialized computer servers and so forth. Now, there are other RAID configurations as well, but they're less common, and there's no need for us to get into them here. The ones I gave you are the most important ones. Now, before I give you my final recommendations, I want to go through a few points about setting up RAID. The first is that you're going to need to tell the Synology unit which RAID you want to use at the start of the setup process. It's like telling your camera which ISO, shutter speed, and aperture you want to use, right? But you want to tell the camera this information before you take your shot and not after. Second, while you can change your RAID type in some cases later on, this can be very time consuming and often very restrictive. Something to note, however, is that if you are in RAID 5, most often you should be able to someday update that to RAID 6 if you want. And third, RAID configurations are more concerned about the number of drives that you have than the size. For example, if you use RAID 5, you can use all 2 terabyte drives, right? Or you can use all 10 terabyte drives. Or you could use a mix of 2 terabyte drives and the 10 terabyte drive and so forth. For this entire video, I have been talking about RAID configurations. These will work across any NAS type system that you purchase, not just the Synology brand. However, if you do decide to go with Synology, they also give you the option of using their own special RAID configuration. This is called Synology Hybrid RAID, or SHR for short. SHR is a Synology specific disk configuration type that was designed around both RAID 5 and RAID 6. There are 2 of them, SHR1 and SHR2. SHR1 is similar to RAID 5, and SHR2 is similar to RAID 6. Think of SHR as a way for beginners to set up their NAS system without having to understand what RAID is. So instead of picking one of these RAID types that I just discussed, you would instead pick one of the SHR types. And there are some advantages to using SHR over RAID. First is that you get a more flexible mix and matching of your storage drives of different sizes later on. The second is that you get a higher overall capacity while still maintaining that one disk of redundancy and parity, right, in the RAID 5 type configuration. And lastly, they're a bit faster to set up and already fully integrated into the Synology system. That being said, you can definitely use either RAID or SHR. And there are 2 main disadvantages to using SHR over RAID. The first is that SHR has been known to run a bit slower than RAID. Back to that in just a second. And the second disadvantage is that if you use SHR, you are locked into the Synology system, meaning that you cannot move your disks, right, to a different NAS system that's not Synology. But back to the speed issue of RAID versus SHR. I have 2 identical Synology DS1621 Plus NAS units with 5 14 terabyte drives in each. One of them I set to RAID 5 and the other one I set to SHR. Everything else was identical and I use both of them every day. I've not noticed any difference whatsoever in speed between RAID 5 or SHR1. Now let me tell you what I recommend regarding RAID and which configuration you should go with. In all cases, forget RAID 0, RAID 1, and RAID 10. Get rid of those. So now we have RAID 5 and RAID 6. RAID 6 definitely gives you more of a safety net than RAID 5. But even RAID 6 could still fail, in theory, if both the first and second recovery drives fail during a restore. Remember what I mentioned at the beginning of this video. RAID is not a backup. It should never replace a good backup strategy. In addition to RAID, you should also be both backing up to another source as well as backing up to an offsite location. So now my official recommendation to you would be to use RAID 6. RAID 6 is safer than RAID 5. And a lot of photographers and creative professionals are dealing with mission-critical client work that needs to be stored for years and is irreplaceable. RAID 6 does give you that extra safety net of double data parity. If you're just starting out and you don't know or care much about this stuff, and you plan on staying with Synology forever, then I wouldn't hesitate to go with SHR. So the bottom line here is either go with RAID 6 or SHR2. RAID 6 is more universal, and SHR2 is a bit more flexible. Now that we got RAID out of the way, we are going to actually start moving into setting up the unit, the type of NAS drives that you need to get, specifically, which models would be best to consider. Understanding data and file management is a marathon, not a sprint, and we're gonna go slowly and carefully with these workshops. Well, thank you so much for watching, and I hope you found the video helpful, or at least entertaining, and if you did, be sure to give it the like and subscribe. I will see you all in another video again very soon. Take care.